Destiny 2 YouTubers that quit the game is the name of this video that's been sent to me. It's from November Hotel. And this sounds like a pretty spicy topic, I have to say. As someone that has dabbled in the dark arts of talking about drama from time to time, but the topic of YouTubers that quit Destiny is definitely a spicy one. And obviously being around since the very beginning and being friends with most people that have played Destiny 2, I'm sure I will know everyone on this list. But let's go ahead and jump into it. Let's see what they are talking about.
Over the last few years, many Destiny YouTubers and Twitch streamers have come and gone. Some of them moved on to different games and found success, and some of them quit YouTube entirely. So today we're taking a look at 9 Destiny YouTubers that have moved on from Destiny or quit YouTube.
Guys, before we kick this video off, I would just like to say thank you guys so much for 50,000 subs. It's pretty crazy that I made this far from just playing video games, but
Long before he was known for being one of the biggest Fortnite channels, Tfue's notoriety began in 2015 with challenge modes in the Crota's End Raid for Destiny 1, posting the first ever 3-man Crota kill. Tfue would continue to post numerous challenges for Crota's End and would eventually go on to be one of the founding members of Clan Redeem, and would continue posting challenges for almost every piece of endgame content in Destiny.
That's actually when I met him. He was streaming solo Crota hard mode, and he wanted to do it on all 3 characters. And I think he also wanted to do it on all 6 subclasses. He wanted to do it on Hunter, Solar, and Arc, and everything. He did all 3. And that was really impressive. A lot of people were starting to watch his stream at that time. And I say a lot, like it was like 300 people, I think. Which at the time, and during Destiny 1, year 1, that was a ton of viewers. And so it was a pretty impressive spectacle to try and solo all that stuff. That's literally, he said it many times, it's how he got his start, and that's how I met him, actually, was just typing in his chat and be like, hey, this is sick. You're doing.
Come the release of the Taken King, Tfue and Clan Redeem would attempt world's first for King's Fall, but they would end up in 26th place. Still, they continued to post speedruns and challenges throughout the year. It wouldn't be until Wrath of the Machine that Tfue and Clan.
That's funny. That's a real throwback right there, because I remember the first time he ever streamed and hit 1,000 viewers was when he was soloing Oryx. And I remember being in the chat and I was like, oh my God, this is crazy. 1,000 viewers? Only to later go on to Fortnite and have like 100,000 viewers on multiple occasions. In fact, there was one stream he did in Fortnite that had like 350,000 viewers. And I was in that stream actually. And I was like, there are 350,000 people watching right now. And I'm in the camera line of sight. I was like, this is nuts.
The team would achieve a world's first raid clear. And following that success, Tfue would continue to grow in popularity by completing more challenges like the 2-man Axis kill. And with the release of Destiny 2, Tfue and Clan Redeem would attempt a world's first clear of the Leviathan raid, but would come up short. And this is around the same time that Tfue was getting into the Battle Royale craze, streaming both H1Z1 and Fortnite. And ultimately, Tfue would find wild success with Fortnite, and would end up leaving Destiny 2 behind. Which ended up working out great for him, becoming one of the biggest Fortnite channels both on Twitch and YouTube.
Fun fact, I know this sounds really obscure, but I bought him that exact controller that's in that thumbnail. He was always roasting people playing with controller, and like various different games added stronger aim assist, especially in Fortnite. So I bought him this controller and gave it to him. I was like, you should roast controller players. That's too funny to see that actually being used in a video. I saw it in a TikTok one time, but I didn't realize it actually is a video. That's too funny.
This has been Patrick Casey with Planet Destiny, your guide to the Destiny universe.
Holtzman, yeah. Went on to work for Bungie.
Patrick Casey, aka Holtzman, was at one time one of the most recognizable content creators for Destiny. Holtzman began his content creation for the YouTube channel Planet Destiny.
Ah, that's a throwback.
Reviews, and host the Planet Destiny podcast. While he wasn't the only creator who worked on the Planet Destiny content, he for sure became the face of the brand, despite not being the one who even created the channel. It wasn't until October 2016 that he would end up leaving Planet Destiny to create content on his own channel, something a lot of other creators had already done, which left Planet Destiny to significantly drop off in viewership following his departure. Holtzman would continue to post reviews and guides on his own channel, and host a new podcast called DCP Live, which included many of the original members of the Planet Destiny podcast. In 2018, Holtzman would end up leaving content creation briefly as he would be hired on at Bungie to fill a gameplay specialist position. And after that 3-month period of time, he would return to streaming and creating content for YouTube, until 2019, where Holtzman would get another contract to work at Bungie as a gameplay tester, which would last for 10 months, leading to another gap in content creation. Now surprisingly, this wouldn't be the last time that this happened, as Holtzman would get another short-term contract to work at Bungie. Only this time, his return to content creation and streaming would be much more sparse, and no longer Destiny focused. Flash forward to December 2021, Holtz would be hired on at Bungie in a much more permanent position.
It's actually really common for Bungie devs, or not Bungie devs, but it's really common for game devs to have such a hard time. They get hired on as an intern for like a 6-month thing. Doesn't work out. They bounce around from different studio to studio. It's very, very hard to find consistent work. I'm happy that Holtzman was able to do so because he's obviously a very passionate Destiny player, and Bungie has a good employee by having him on there. So definitely excited to see that he got full-time work
as an associate AI designer. Quite a journey for Holtzman, going from a reputable content creator for Destiny to working on the studio that develops the game.
One half health.
Lupo.
I see the jump snipe on Truth again, and hit the other jump snipe to win. GG.
Nice.
Good game, guys.
Nice clip.
Dr. Lupo began his Twitch and YouTube career with the release of Trials of Osiris in Destiny 1. And for nearly 2 years, Lupo was one of the most popular Destiny streamers centered around Trials and other PvP-related content. And understandably, his gameplay was addicting to watch, and he was one of the few mouse and keyboard players on the game, even with the game being console-only at the time, so that was pretty interesting. In 2016,
he's talking about Zim. That was actually before Zim was a bannable offense. He used to use a Zim on console so he could play with a mouse and keyboard. It was actually pretty controversial. Like, people thought that it was like cheating and stuff, and people tried to claim it was cheating, but it wasn't a bannable offense, so he just did it anyways. And like, I don't really think it gave him that much of an advantage at the time. I think that using a Zim on PC to have aim assist is definitely a much worse offense. But he was just using it to rock a mouse and keyboard on console, which actually grew his channel, grew his brand, because a lot of people were like, what is this guy doing? Is this guy cheating? Like, everyone would go to his stream and be like, is this guy cheating? Everyone would talk, like, it built up his notoriety using that Zim, which is too funny to think about looking back now. Like, that he was a Zim user is like such a controversial input device now, but back then it wasn't as known or bannable, at least by Bungie.
Lupo had begun branching out to other games like Overwatch and PUBG, and in early 2017, H1Z1, around the same time that he would become a full-time streamer, he would begin focusing on the battle royale genre, which would pay off big time with the release of Fortnite later that year. Lupo quickly grew on Twitch, reaching a subscriber count of nearly 33,000, and continued to thrive with the battle royale genre. And during the last few years, he has returned to Destiny 2 several times, very briefly for a few streams, but ultimately has found success outside of the game that he began his career with.
Now, being something of a streamer historian and obviously knowing all of these guys myself, I'm like a streamer dinosaur at this point. Like, I've just been doing it for so long, I remember every little detail of everything that happened with all the different Destiny circles and stuff. His story of Dr. Lupo is accurate, but it's very scarce, I would say. The real story of kind of what happened along the way was he played a bunch of PUBG and he killed Ninja in PUBG. And then that created a little like mini rivalry, but like they didn't dislike each other, but it was like he killed Ninja and he threw a grenade on like top of a building and killed him, and just kind of just like a wild kill more than anything. So after he killed Ninja, they kind of became friends a little bit there, and then that's what carried on into Fortnite. So like, as Ninja became the number one Fortnite player in the entire world at the very start of Fortnite's launch and success, Dr. Lupo was his right hand man, and they together were like a duo pair. Ninja would often solo and win all these different solo matches like crazy, but whenever he would do duos, he would play with Lupo. So it was like Lupo was Ninja's best friend, and that's literally what grew him, grew his brand, and grew his success to such heights. Obviously, he's branched off away from playing with Ninja so much now, and he plays more stuff like, I think, Escape from Tarkov and stuff. But really, it was Fortnite paired with Ninja that kind of blew him up stratosphere with all those crazy millions of followers and stuff. I find it fascinating just because I was like there and I remember all the different things that happened. I find it fun to listen to other people describe it too.
What is going on, guys? Wally here with another portion of the Lore series. And today,
this is someone I haven't heard of.
Try to better define and better understand the Traveler. So without any further ado, let's get right into it.
Sir Wallen was the first Destiny lore channel I discovered back in 2014, and quickly became a favorite of mine. But Wallen started making content years prior as a Battlefield creator, before creating Destiny content. And just a few days after Destiny 1 launched, Wallen would post his first lore video about the Fallen, reading from Grimoire cards, and sharing his thoughts on the story.
Learned something new.
He continued to post more Destiny-related content, sprinkling in some lore videos as time went on. However, his lore content would be his most popular, and pretty quickly he began focusing more on lore videos solely, and would be the primary content creator for making lore videos for Destiny at the time.
Wow.
He would also make regular appearances on the Planet Destiny podcast.
That's pretty crazy.
And create weapon reviews for them as well. Over the next year or so, around the time of the Taken King, Wallen began posting less and less on his channel, and became more critical of Bungie and Destiny. And with the release of The Division, he began posting both guides and lore videos related to that game for a few months. He would return to creating Destiny lore videos at a much less frequent rate. However, he also created lore videos surrounding other franchises like Star Wars, The Elder Scrolls, and Mass Effect. And Sir Wallen would continue to post the occasional lore for Destiny 2, but his last video on the subject is from over 2 years ago.
Jeez. So he's the Wallen. I've never heard of this Wallen guy, admittedly, and that's pretty cool to see that. There's so many new people that were brought to Destiny 1. Like, it was such a huge surge of new people. Sounds like this guy was like the Bife before Bife, potentially. And I don't remember what Bife's first video was or if he predates that by any means, but I know Bife's been around since the beginning. It's cool to see that there was like other lore people at the very start. Pretty fascinating stuff.
To today's video, where I'll be guiding you through the normal version of the 0 hour secret mission and helping you beat it solo.
Ninja Pups is a YouTuber who had been creating content for almost 10 years, who really hit their stride creating Destiny 2 guides. From finding collectibles to solo flawlessing dungeons, Ninja Pups was your go-to channel for tips and tricks in Destiny 2. In April of 2021, Ninja Pups posted a YouTube video titled Moving On, with the message centered around leaving YouTube to pursue other avenues in life, and simply wanting to leave behind content creation. Definitely an unexpected announcement, but one that I can respect.
That one really did come out of the blue. I did not expect someone that was so established and so well known within the community to just leave. I don't know necessarily make. I mean, obviously everyone's welcome to do what they want, but it's like when you invest so much time, effort, and energy into something, you kind of hope that someone, you know, they have to step away for a while, step away, or if they have to do it just part-time or one video a month or one video a year, you know, just do that. You know, I think sometimes people really commit to like, I am doing this 100%, and if I'm not doing it 100%, then I'm not doing it at all, you know? And that's the way people might be, you know? And that's totally fine if they want to handle themselves. But I do find it a bit disjarring when people have established such a huge audience. Like, he had like 100,000+ subscribers and he just left. That's his own decision, I guess. It definitely was super surprising. I did not see that coming at all. At that point in time, I don't think we'd seen anyone kind of leave that had such a sizable audience. And he was actually getting decent viewership too.
Hey everyone, Entaz here, and welcome to another
this one's big, yeah.
Crucible School. On this one, we're going to be talking about why you feel like you're getting worse at this game. Why you feel like you suck.
Mtash began his channel centered around real-life situations and scenarios, primarily in a comedic context, but quickly changed up his content once he started finding success with the occasional Destiny upload. From PvP to PvE, Mtash covered many different aspects of the game, and really began to blow up with his Crucible School series, where he provided tips and tricks to help players improve at PvP. And he would primarily focus on PvP-related content for the duration of his time covering Destiny, and also grew a very successful Twitch channel, and for over 5 years would be a notable creator in the Destiny community, even shoutcasting for Destiny 1's esport tournaments. Well, in September 2020, Mtash would make a major change with the release of Genshin.
Yep, that's when the hentai got him. I mean, the anime game got him.
Impact. He would find incredible success with Genshin Impact content creation on YouTube, rising to be one of the biggest creators in the Genshin community, getting millions of views. Pair that success with what seemed like him losing interest in Destiny 2, we see one of the most popular Destiny YouTubers and streamers make a complete change to Genshin-only content. And it's really worked out well for him too, gaining over 150,000 subscribers in the first month of his Switch. And while he's made a few videos about Destiny 2 since the Switch, they've only ever been a one-off here and there, and it appears Genshin is the future of his channel.
That was a pretty wild switch for Mtash. He was so well established in Destiny 1 and Destiny 2, very well known. And then he started to make these Genshin videos, and I guess he saw something that very few other people did. And he was at the right place at the right time, making the right content. He kind of became like the initial catalyst of Genshin content. The channel just absolutely blew up. He's almost at 1 million subscribers at the time recording this now, almost entirely from Genshin content, which is just crazy to think about. Which is also an important thing to note, that a lot of people who are you see a common theme with video games and with content creators' popularity, which is kind of being the first to play a game. Like, a good example is Gathalion is one of the first to play Destiny, even though 9 years later, Gathalion is still like a name that's tossed around in terms of like Destiny content creator legends. And same thing with Genshin for Mtash. He's one of the initial content creators that grinded Genshin. He's like a Gathalion of that game. And same thing like we talked about before with Fortnite and Dr. Lupo, right? Ninja was the first to jump into Fortnite, so he's like the guy of Fortnite. Still has that sort of lore about him, and Emtash just found the right, was at the right place at the right time and just jumped right into this game, and it worked out really well for him. Very difficult to leave Destiny content when you get kind of rooted in it, not because of Destiny players in general, it's just your channel has a niche, and when you leave your niche, you lose so much viewership and retention, which is very punishing of leaving your niche. So the fact that he was able to leave and somehow find massive success almost instantly, it was just crazy. Very cool. One of the coolest transitions out of Destiny that I've ever seen.
What's going on, guys? It's your boy DPJ here today with another
DPJ! The homie!
Five reactions to that Galahorn dropping.
DPJ was a content creator who posted funny moments and highlight clips from various games prior to Destiny 1's launch. But his channel exploded with the release of Destiny. Guides, funny moments, anything related to Destiny, this guy was on top of covering it. He stopped posting Destiny content prior to Beyond Light's launch, and would make a Why I Quit Destiny video almost 2 years after he switched up his content, citing things like cancel culture, a toxic community, and simply just being burnt out and bored with the game. And he said while the money was good, he just didn't want to continue posting content about Destiny.
DPJ is an interesting one. I think he's come back to Destiny various different times that I've seen, at least. He still does play mostly other games, but he has come back to play Destiny here and there. He got kind of a reputation of being like clickbaity, but I personally never really saw it. But people try to like give people false reputations and false ideas about them based on their type of content, the type of videos that they make. So definitely sucks that he was like harassed a bunch and decided to leave. But I think he's doing well playing other games right now, so hopefully he's happy with that.
This is SC Slurridge. If you feel like your 2 of Destiny hasn't stood up to your 1, this video is for you.
Slayeridge, aka the legend himself, was a Destiny
YouTuber
who gained notoriety by being one of the first to post Destiny challenges, meaning things like raid solos or low man raid completions.
His first big one, casually soloing Crota, that blew up. Legend himself, casually soloing Crota from Slayeridge. That video hit the stratosphere. I remember seeing that. I think that was like what inspired so many other people. I imagine Tfue, Glad, Oliver Deem, all of them kind of saw that and were like, whoa. That really launched challenges in Destiny.
And his first being,
and he was the guy.
Vaulted Glass Run. But the most notable achievement that skyrocketed him into this rise of fame was achieving the world's first solo Crota run,
yeah,
which he did just a week after it released. He would continue to impress with various other solos, low mans, speedruns, and even PvP montages throughout the next few years. In Destiny 2, Slayeridge's team would be the first to complete the Leviathan raid, which was a huge accomplishment. However, this would be the first and last time he would find himself getting first place in a raid race, with his next closest being third place in Deepstone Crypt. In Destiny 2, he would continue to do low man and solo challenges, but in late 2021, his Destiny content slowed down, with his last Destiny video on YouTube being posted in November of 2021, and on Twitch has made a shift to mostly Overwatch 2 streams.
I didn't realize that he had left. I figured he was just taking some time off. That's crazy. I didn't realize that he was streaming mostly Overwatch and not playing Destiny anymore. It's crazy to think about how big the Destiny community is, though, where someone can start to like leave or go. And if they sort of just quietly play other games, you don't really notice as much versus people who kind of like a big, huge spectacle out of it. Like, I'm playing another game. I'm not playing Destiny anymore. It's like it kind of grabs your attention. But I feel like he very quietly just started playing other stuff. No one really noticed. Like, good for him. Like, I don't feel bad for him. Like, he's obviously still a legend in the Destiny, right? That solo Crota, I'll still never remember that. Solo Crota was crazy, and the world's first also.
Hey everyone, in this video, I'm taking my buddy Fregzy, who is a fresh New Light player, through some of the secret missions and dungeons in Destiny 2.
Marco Style was one of my favorite Destiny 2 creators for a very brief period of time that he was making content for the game. Starting out as a Division YouTuber who dropped off after being disappointed with the Division 2 in 2019, Marco Style would give Destiny 2 a try in July of that year, and quickly became one of the best channels in the community. Where in the Division, Marco would do guides and discussion videos on the game, with Destiny 2 he'd create some very highly edited, high quality, funny moment style videos, sharing his raiding experience and hilarious moments with his friends.
Unstable energy.
No, we can actually damage.
Big damage.
Wait, that's it? That's the whole mechanic?
No, they're taking me, Marco!
Oh, goodness. The fuck, what are you guys doing?
Bruh.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
They were taking me.
But almost 2 years later, Marco began posting less Destiny, and briefly switched up to posting Valorant gameplay. And after some backlash from fans who wanted to see more of his Destiny content, he would address the topic in a video where he shared some of his thoughts on the game. He talked about Destiny 2 becoming a bit boring for him, and he was getting a bit tired of the formulaic content release schedule that the game had, and followed up in another video with some more thoughts on the monetization of the game getting out of hand. Since then, Marco Style has still posted Destiny 2, although much less frequently, and branched out to other games and topics with a more recent switch to long-form video essay-style content, which is also really high quality, and I'm anxiously awaiting to see what he'll post next.
Yeah, Marco has made some really high quality stuff. He's definitely a legend. Bad to see anyone leave Destiny when it's not necessarily, like 2 years ago, it wasn't necessarily doing that bad, at least in terms of popularity, it was doing well. Right now, obviously, there's a lot of people kind of reeling and leaving, but Marco, he can still come back at any point in time, and he does make really, really good videos, some of the funniest videos.
Now, this isn't all the Destiny YouTubers who have quit or left the game. Others have even been pushed out or banned, but maybe we'll cover that topic in another video. Hope you enjoyed the video. Leave a like if you did, and I'll see you all in the next one.
Definitely a cool video from November Hotel there, highlighting some of the people that quit. I'm trying to think, as someone that's been around since the beginning, if there's like anyone I would even add to that list. Obviously there's people that got banned, so let's not create a ban list. Well, that'll be an entirely different video. There was some people back in the beginning of Destiny that were real OGs that I used to watch. Ramez05, that guy was a real OG back in the day. He used to stream raid carries and raid helps, and I think he's transitioned on to Division. I can't remember now. No one will remember this. This is a throwback that 0.001% people will remember, which would be Couch Team Gaming. Yeah, Crafty. Real Crafty is an excellent. Real Crafty should have been on that list for sure. Real Crafty. He still comes back and plays every now and again, but he definitely has quit compared to like what he was doing in the beginning. Couch Team Gaming was a big streamer, huge stream, raid helps, but he kind of didn't stop after like the first year. Yeah, Crafty is like the goat of trials for sure. Crafty is for sure a legend of trials in Destiny. I'm trying to think of anyone else that's like super notable that played a ton and has left. I mean, there's like people that play and then leave still regularly. Like Githalion technically doesn't really play Destiny regularly, but that was a long time ago that he transitioned out. So I don't know if I would really say he's quit Destiny. Glad has kind of quit Destiny. Glad you wouldn't say is a Destiny player anymore. Like he's kind of variety, right? Like Crafty, Valiant, Glad could all make that list. Mr. Fruit. Yeah, Mr. Fruit was a huge Destiny player that doesn't really play as much anymore. I think he occasionally plays as well. That's the thing too, is like, how do you want to define quitting? You know, if someone was a Destiny player that played full time and became full time off of Destiny and then they quit, does that count as them quitting? You know, definitely a bunch you could throw on that list, which is pretty cool. And actually I see here it says Destiny 2 YouTubers who quit part too, so apparently he's got an entirely another list as well. Slayerge was on that list. Lupo was on that list. Anyone that got banned though, he didn't put on the list, and I think it's probably fair because it's not like they chose to quit. You know, they chose, people that chose to leave is a different topic. It kind of highlights why they chose to leave and like what point in time in Destiny's history did they choose to leave. Esoteric definitely still makes videos. Definitely. Esoteric is making great videos regularly. Very cool video. Very fun topic to talk about. I feel like I would almost make a deep dive of that topic, talk about the elements of why they left. You know, it'd be almost cool to have like an interview with each person and be like, why did you leave Destiny? What was it that caused you to leave? And stuff like that. Because I feel like that would be a fun topic. Obviously, you only get what we see, and like they were playing Destiny and then they chose to leave for these reasons, you know? I think that I know, like in terms of like insider information that I might know, I remember like for Tfue, it was Destiny 2 came out pretty shitty. So he immediately was just like trying to transition away. I think that he quit for a little while to Battle Royale, but then he came back and then he just immediately quit again because it didn't really work for him. Cactus uploads all the time. I know there's a lot of people forget about some of the content creators. Maybe you subscribe to them, maybe you unsubscribe to them because you were not interested in their content or whatever it may be. But it's funny, sometimes you get the idea of like, oh, I haven't seen this person upload in forever. But cool, very cool video. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, and as always, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Later.